I'll tell you two interesting cases where remembrance of past lives, okay?
Yeah.
Remembrance of past lives can occur either, as you said, in very developed persons, or it can also occur in not so developed persons. I'll give you two examples. It's very interesting. Yeah. There was a farmer boy, okay, in Punjab. This is actually, it was, I saw the program on our Indian TV. So he, when he was about 10 years old or so, he remembered his past life. And he said, I was such and such a person, my wife's name was such and such, I had a tractor accident and this is how the accident took place. He described the whole thing in great detail. His parents were not taking him seriously at all in the beginning, but when he was insisting, they said, okay, let's see, we'll do something. And they made inquiries and they found the village to which he was referring, went there and checked. And here is 10-year-old boy pointing out to a 35-year-old woman and saying, she was my wife in the last life. And they confirmed all that he was saying. So sometimes, see, after birth, how far are you going in? The animals don't go beyond the vital world because they have no mind. So depending at what level they have developed, after death they go up to that level and then take birth again. The animals go up to the vital level and take birth again. Human beings who are not very developed, they go maybe a little in the mental worlds and then take birth again. There is not much time to wipe out the old memories. This can happen. So in this case, he was obviously a very old, very simple farmer, but he remembered all the details because he took birth almost immediately.
Yeah.
There's another case like that in Syria or, you know, that Iraq area. I think this was in Lebanon. And Lebanon, there are several cases like that. One particular boy remembered that he was murdered, and he remembered the name of the murderer also, and he even said how he was injured, and in this life there was even a mark of how he was hit on the head or something like that, I've forgotten exactly what, but he described even the weapon. And when he insisted so much, they took him to the place. He identified the man who had murdered him.
Mm-hmm.
And that fellow's face became pale. And he even said, I know where the murder weapon is. And he identified the murder weapon.
Oh.
I've read this in the newspapers. So this also is a case where you are not very developed, but you remember. I'll give you another striking case, okay, of a very young boy, 5-year-old boy in the US. He is watching TV and he goes on naming all the planes. He says, this plane is called this, this plane is called this. And his parents used to wonder from where he has got all this information. Is he looking in books or anything? Anyway, they were puzzled. One day he came out with this striking, I crashed in that plane, which he was seeing on the TV. I crashed in that plane. Then they got interested and they made inquiries and they found that he had actually crashed in the Second World War, and it was in Japan somewhere or something. And the plane that he had described was absolutely that, same plane. So, here is a case of memory, it was verified, and this is not in India or somewhere where people can be hazy, you know. It was in the US, okay? And they are very materialistic, so it is absolutely proved that he was right, absolutely. So, it can happen. So, very developed souls, of course, mothers, they remember all that. But even at the non-developed state also, it can happen because you are coming back pretty quickly after death. That also can happen.
Now, when they choose the new Dalai Lama, they have certain tests of the child to see. They'll put different things out there, prayer beads and different things. And it seems to have been right every time.
I don't know about that. Depends on who is selecting, nah, and who is, how open they are. Of course, the lamas are pretty developed. Of course, there is,
yes,
no doubt about that. But how developed and how authentic the process is, I don't know. But that's what they do. I know that. And they see with some tests they do to see whether this is really the child. I don't know.
Yeah. Nalini said he was the gardener at Versailles. For the Sun King.
Oh.
He told this to you personally, or?
No, I've read it.
You've heard? You've read it?
I've read it, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Who was the Sun King?
Ludovic
XV. Vasanti may have told us. I'm not sure though. But I know it for a fact. I've either read it or someone.
Who told you?
It might have been Vasanti.
Ah, Vasanti, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
She has encyclopedic knowledge.
But in Reckon's book, two or three lives are mentioned of Nalini along with mother. Like when she was Elizabeth the Queen, so he was one of the ministers. Even the name was there.
Danton?
No.
Was he not Danton?
No.
That was Sri Aurobindo. Yeah. Okay. Well, we have an interesting evening ahead of us. We can tell some interesting remembrances of the early ashramites. And I have a couple of Amrita.
So, go ahead.
One of the most famous is, and one of the most humorous, where he says that it is true that the gods gave Savitri to the world, but among themselves they speak Tamil. And another one is when he was walking, rushing out of the ashram, and this very lovely lady was coming in, and he bumps her. And she says, "I'm so sorry." He says, "I'm not."
Yeah.
And then there's the story of mother who would throw sweets to all the group around her. And he would be going like this. And mother would say, "Why are you doing this? I'm throwing you a sweet." He said, "Mother, I'm trying to catch what's behind it." It's very interesting.
Yeah.
And the last one I have, Alok said it was Champaklal, but I don't know. I thought it was Amrita. When mother was ill, and they said, "Mother, you have to have chicken soup." Mother says, "I'm a vegetarian. I don't eat chicken." And Amrita said, "Mother, if I were a chicken, I would want you to eat me."
Yeah.
And mother took the soup.
This is Champaklal.
It's Champaklal.
And the stories are slightly, there are differences here and there.
Good.
So in Champaklal's case, he said, mother objected. She said, you're going to kill a chicken for me every day? No, I can't accept this. Then Champaklal comes and says, mother, make me a chicken and I will die every day for you. That's what he said. So that is Champaklal, yes. It's a well-known story.
Mm-hmm.
And Amrita, there are many, many stories about Amrita.
You said
two more I will add to you.
Okay, good, okay? Good. So,
one, he is in the Wednesday class. And he used to work a lot. He was a manager of the Sridhartha Ashram. And he had huge responsibilities and he used to work throughout. Now, which is the accounts room in the meditation hall, the second room. He used to live there and his office also was there only. He used to live in a small antechamber. He used to live there. So that day he was a little sleepy and he was dozing a little bit. And mother suddenly asked him a question. He said, "What do you think about this, Amrita?"
Oh, yeah.
So he comes out and says, "Mother, I was sincerely, very sincerely, I was sleeping." There is another story about him also, when she used to have translation classes. Okay, she used to translate the synthesis, and now those rooms are not there in the playground anymore. They have all been made into gymnasiums and all that. But there used to be many rooms, and mother's storeroom is still maintained, but the other rooms have all been broken down and the gymnasium has been built. So there, mother used to take translation classes. She used to translate synthesis and many of the elder sadhaks used to attend. They used to go. So one day, Amrita happened to come a little late and he went in and he sat down at his desk. And mother was discussing the relation between the supermind and the ordinary mind.
Yes,
so she said, "Amrita, what is the relation between the supermind and the normal mind?"
Yes.
He says, "Mother, very good relation, very good relation. They are on very good terms." When he was above 60, once he had a heart attack. And people asked him, "How are you?" He said, "My sweetheart is troubling me." He was full of humor and he was so humble a man. He was wonderful. But since we are talking about him, you may not know this story also, because he was from a very staunch Orthodox Brahmin family.
Oh, yes.
You know that story probably about his...
Tell that.
And Sri Ramda wanted to break him away from his tradition, because the traditions are fine, but they also have limits, and Mother and Sri Ramda, they are breaking the old tradition paths and building new paths. So one day, Sri Ramda ordered his tuft of hair, Adi. You know, the Brahmins, you have seen how they shave the whole head and keep only a tuft here. So Sri Ramda said, cut it off.
And I think he told Nalini, didn't he?
No, I think it was Nalini who did that.
Nalini cut it
off. So he cut it off. And when he woke up, he saw that his stuff had been highly disturbed. Highly disturbed. What will my family say to me? How will I show them my face and all that? But finally, he adjusted himself.
He was supposed to get married also. And he said, both sensible Brahmin girl will marry you without this. You know, that was a purposely done.
That marriage story is slightly different. It's another story. He used to go and see a local girl on the beach. You know. And he went on. Finally, the girl's family said that, why don't you get married? So he put it to Sri Ramda, and Sri Ramda said, nothing doing. And then he asked him, did you know that this was happening? Sri Ramda said, of course I knew. Then why didn't you stop me from it earlier? Now at the last minute you're telling me, why didn't you stop me earlier? He said, I was seeing how far you will go. These are all authentic stories.
Yes, yes.
And what was that story about seeing a vision when he was...
That's something. When he was a very young boy, he saw that light, a light coming. Because there was a fairly developed yogi who had so forecast that a yogi from the north will come and settle here in this area. It was well known. And Amrita saw this light coming like that towards Pondicherry, and then when he heard that Sri Ramda had come here, the news had spread. It's not that people in Pondicherry did not know about it. They knew, but Sri Ramda was not coming out anywhere, and it was supposed to be pretty hush-hush because the English were not supposed to know that he was here in Pondicherry. And he tried very often to see Sri Ramda. He used to come and hover around that house all the time, wanting to meet Sri Ramda and all that, but they won't allow him to go in. But his Tamil friend, through Subramanya Bharati, that famous poet of Tamil Nadu, finally one day managed to get a chance to go and see Sri Ramda. And he said, you will have a meal with Sri Ramda. So he was very happy. But when he went there, he was offered bread and butter. And for a South Indian, bread and butter is absolutely total alien food, because they are used to only sambar and rice. But he was so happy. And then finally, when it started, he became the manager of the ashram. And he also became the, he was running the, doing all the work for the Arya. It was he who was doing all the main work. Mm. I remember one case where Mother sent him. I used to have some skin problems when I was very young, particularly on the neck and all that. It used to be a lot of skin problem used to be there. I was very young. I was about 10 or 11 years old. Then my father took me to Mother and said, Mother, look, this is what it is. And then I was made to go through homeopathy and all that, and Mother knew about it. But slowly, slowly, with the homeopathy treatment, it disappeared. Okay. So, largely the problem was solved. One day, there was a Russian lady from the US. She was a skin specialist. She had come here, and Mother remembered and told Amrita to take the doctor to see me. Okay. And I was very surprised when she came, and Amrita told me, I have brought this skin specialist, and Mother has instructed me to bring her to you. So, we sat in the car and went to the pharmacy, and she made a prescription and we got a medicine. On the way, this lady is asking Amrita, Amrita, what do you do in the ashram? What's your function? Remember, he is the manager of the ashram press. All the financial burdens and everything is on him. And he says, I see to the convenience of everybody. Such humility he had. A wonderful man.
Do you remember the story about Vashistha Ganapati Muni?
Yes.
Could you tell that?
Yeah, but which one particularly?
When he came to the ashram.
I'm not sure about the details, but I do know that he came here because of Kabari Shastri.
You said yesterday about something you read in the archives, Amrita's diary.
Yes, yes, yes. I'll tell you that. And that's a very interesting story. He was the manager of the ashram and he was doing most of the work before the other trustees came in. Because before the trustee also, he was the only one. He used to go to mother with all the check signings and all the official papers and all this he used to do. And mother used to be pretty rough with him. You know, she used to be pretty rough. In fact, mother's language sometimes used to be quite rough. There was a small girl who had gone to a dentist, and that was that Koroth. His name was Koroth, and he was a Malayali doctor. He was a dentist. And mother asked the child, said, "Animal tafe mal?" Yes, this animal hurt you while he was... So she was very caustic, and she used to use all this type of language. Once she used, I'm diverting a little bit. Once she called Amal Kiran. Imagine, Amal Kiran, she called him an imbecile. Said, "An imbecile," she said. So here is Amal, who goes about looking at the dictionary and finding out what is the meaning of imbecile. And he has a huge article in Mother India analyzing who an imbecile is. So this particular case, you know, that whole block, which is the post office block, mm-hmm. near the ashram from the dispensary, that whole block belongs to the ashram, except that corner building, which is the foyer, the solda. Okay? At one time in the 60s, mother was very busy buying up properties. She tried to buy up a lot of properties all around. And of course, they started in the 20s also. Even the Golkond was built on a plot with three Tamil houses. And Srivindra is instructing, keep these news of our trying to buy these houses secret. Otherwise, they'll start raising their prices. So he instructed that in one of the letters. Wow. And they were bought at what price, you remember? You will be surprised to know. 5,000 rupees, 6,000 rupees. In those days, the rupee was pretty valuable. Now it is 60 rupees per dollar. But in those days, it would be 5 rupees, 6 rupees for the dollar. So 5,000 rupees in those days, a full house was worth 5,000 rupees. The Trezor Nursing Home was bought for 5,000 rupees. So they bought these three houses and then they built the Golkond. So mother was told him, go and negotiate for the foyer, the solda also. I want that property. Okay. But that fellow was asking for a price, which at that time was 500 rupees more than what Amrita was offering. So Amrita said, no, I'm not going to buy this. So we lost the deal. And when mother came to know about it, she was very annoyed. She was very, very annoyed. Other properties also we tried to buy, but it could not succeed all the time. By the side of the press, there was a Hotel Continental. Mm-hmm. Now they have built that Ambedkar Mandapam, they have built. Mm-hmm. That was a hotel at one time. Mother wanted to buy that property also. There also we failed. Anyway, so here when mother heard that he has not paid 500 rupees more to get that property, 500 rupees in those days was a pretty large sum. It wasn't as small as it is today. Mother was very annoyed and she told him, "Vuseta foo, you are a fool. Do you realize? Do you understand what I am telling you? You are a fool. We mad. Yes, mother. Yes, mother," he went on. And so I used to, when I heard this story, and this is a story I have heard from a person very close to me who used to be frequently with mother. You know, there was several girls used to be there who used to be all the time with mother. So this, they have seen this happen. So I used to wonder why mother is so rough with this person. Okay, in fact, earlier also, there are some interesting stories. I'll conclude the story later on. But one day, mother also scolded him and he came down the stairs in a very, very disturbed condition. And he says, "I'm never going to see the mother again. I'm never going to see..." He's mumbling to himself and saying, "I'm never going to see the mother again." You see? Then someone from the... It may have been Amrita or something. "Amrita, mother is calling you once again." He was coming down the stairs and he was muttering like this. As soon as he heard mother is calling him, he rushed up again. Look, the outer nature and the inner nature.
Ah, yes.
The outer nature is feeling the pain of the egoism, but inside totally surrendered. As soon as Mother, he is saying, I'll never see Mother again, as soon as he's told, he rushes up the stairs. Then, as I told you, I used to feel a little curious about this. Recently, I think I have been working in archives now for a fairly long, not archives, I used to work in archives from 2000 to 2006. I continued, but after 2006, my work in knowledge increased. I was asked to teach, and I started there, so the classes started increasing, I had to give up archives. But I go there on the first of every month. Maybe a year ago or 6 months ago, I don't remember exactly, Amrita's diary came into my hands, and I was looking at it.
Oh.
And there's an entry there which says, I want Mother to be very severe with me, because I want to really make progress, because Mahakali attacks those who are her favorites, and she uses violence to turn them round, not softness. And I want Mother to be very severe with me. She must scold me. She must put me on the right track by harsh treatment. I was stunned. So here is proof that what he wants, Mother is doing exactly what he wants.
Oh.
It's a beautiful story.
Yes. What of the, who amongst the oldest sadhaks did you know best?
I was pretty close to Amal at one time, because I was extremely attracted to his way of writing and his character and his poetry and all. I was very, very attracted to him. So I was pretty close to him. I was very close to Nirodha also. Nirodha used to come to our house regularly. My sister used to send him food, and he used to enjoy that. He used to come to our house to watch even tennis. He was very fond of tennis, and even cricket he started becoming. So he was very fond. And my father had invited both Nirodh and Amalda. They were very good friends, by the way. Nirodha and Amal, they were both very good friends. They were also friends with Dilip Kumar Roy. So they used to come, my father had invited them for dinner. Twice or thrice they had come to our house. So I knew them well. Nirodha, we used to have classes, and he was very intimate with him also. He used to take our classes. And after my schooling, also we used to go to his place twice a week, and we used to read Sri Aurobindo's books.
Hmm.
So I was quite close to Nirodha. In fact, now I remember one incident with Nirodha also. About Champaklal, a book was brought out by the Baroda Center. The Baroda Center brought out a book on Champaklal. And on the cover of the book, they wanted to put a picture of Champaklal with a halo around his head. Okay, they came to print it in the press. And I said, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to do this. Mother was not there at that time. This is much harder. I said, no, this is not the proper thing. We are not in the business of aggrandizing our own people. So I don't agree to this. Put a picture of him, but don't put a halo around his head. What the hell is this? This is not proper. Then they got very annoyed with me. And they said, we are not putting the halo. It has come by itself in a photograph. And then they brought the negative and showed me. I said, even if that is a fact, I will not do it. Because how will other people know that this is a real thing? They will interpret it in a different way. And there is no need to do this. This news went and complained to Nirodha. And they told him that this fellow, he is refusing to print Champaklal's picture with a halo around his head. So Nirodha was pretty annoyed, and he called me. And he told me, why are you refusing to do it? So I had to explain to him that, see, Nirodha, are we in the business of magnifying and grand, making our own sadhaks grand and look wonderful in the eyes of the world? Then he understood the point and he said, yes, you are quite right. We should not have done it.
I have a story of Amal in his later years when he was bedridden in the nursing home. And one day, his voice is quite loud, as you know.
Yes.
He's crying out, I want to die. I want to die. And they rush the doctor in, and the doctor says, sir, he says, you're a sadhak. How can you be saying that? And he says, I want to dye my hair.
Yeah. This was typical of him. He was full of humor.
Oh yes.
I'll give you a few examples of his humor.
Good.
So, he was, and such a wit. And that's one of the things that attracted me to him. Tremendous wit. And that psychic character. He was very, very psychic. There's no doubt about it. So, one day, his telephone number and the telephone number of Oro Food, okay, there is only one digit difference. So when I told the secretary in the press to please connect me to Oro Food, I need to talk. They were our customers and we used to do a lot of work for them. So she dialed and she got Amal's number instead of Oro Food. And when the phone was passed on to me, I said, hello, is there Oro Food? Immediately Amal says, no, this is Amal Drink. You may have heard of this. This is Amal Drink. Not Oro Food, but Amal Drink. He was full of fun. There are some jokes that I can't even tell you. Another very simple one, but this is about Aster, but it's a very innocent joke, so I'll tell you. You know Aster?
Oh yes.
You know her very well, Aster Patel?
Very well.
You know her. Okay. So when she was young, she used to be very dandy and she used to dress up well and look smart and all that. You know, and maybe she likes to do that even now, but I don't know. Anyway. So someone went and asked Amal, the word asterisk, okay, that little starry thing which you put on. So they said, what is the word exactly? Is it asterisk or is it asterisk? So Amal answered, aster is always a risk. So, this story reached Aster herself, okay? And she went and told Amal, Amal, you are making up all sorts of stories about me. What the hell are you insulting about me? He said, wait. That was only half the story. I wanted to finish the sentence, but they didn't allow me to finish the sentence. What I meant was, Aster is always a risk worth taking. You have such so much wit he had in him. You know, there's another story about him. He used to make limericks. You know what a limerick is, no? A limerick is a 5-line poem with a particular pattern of rhyming. Okay, so, and they are usually used for very simple jokes and all that. And so in this case, he made a limerick on Udar. Udar was quite a character. Okay. By the way, I had very good relation with Udar also. Oh. Yeah. Because he was our trustee and I had to deal with him a lot. And I had a very interesting incident with him, I'll tell you afterwards, okay, in the press. So, Udar was very fond of, like Amal, very fond of women. Okay, so he used to go out with mixing with local girls and all that. And there was a local girl called Flora. Okay, and he was mixing with her quite a lot. So, Amal made a limerick on him. His name was Lawrence Pinto. Okay, so. No, her name was Flory, I think. Her name was Flory, not Flora. So he said, there was a young man named Lorry, for whom we all feel sorry. In spite of his wits, he fell into pits, the deepest of which was Flory. And he comes out with this. He was full of fun. That was one aspect of him.
Yes.
He fell into pits, the deepest of which, in spite of his wits, he fell into pits.
You were going to tell something about Udar.
Yes. You know, I used to be in the press and mother started this Sri Aurobindo's action at one time. She said, this is now what I want. This is the right time. It was around 1970 or so. And she said, this is the right time. We must spread Sri Aurobindo's words and we must do a lot of work in this area. Okay. Then, and that time, Nandini Satpathy, who was chief minister in Orissa at that time, I think she was chief minister 2 or 3 times. She was very close to mother, and she was also very close to Indira Gandhi. There are pictures with mother and Indira Gandhi and Nandini Satpathy together. So Nandini Satpathy used to come here regularly, and that is one of the reasons why there are 600 integral life schools in Orissa, and there are 300 centers. Orissa has woken up like anything to mother and Sri Aurobindo. Anyway, so at that time, Udar went to, because of this connection, he went to there to Orissa and he started some new businesses. Okay, he was building cheap houses and all that. She was giving him the contracts and he was doing that. He left the Harpagam workshop and he went there for a long time. Then when this thing came up, he said, I want to found the spiritual party of India. So he said, I want to start this spiritual party of India because mother is very keen that the word should be spread. So he came to the press and said, print a letterhead for me, and the letterhead will be spiritual party of India, and I want the map of the entire map of India as it is on the, in the playground. So I was a little puzzled. I said, how the hell can I do this, because we know that politics is forbidden in the ashram. You can't do that. So mother was not there at that time. This much after mother passed away. So I told the manager at that time, I was never the manager, I never was, but I used to look after the work. So I told the manager, you please handle this case because this is a very delicate situation. I will not tell him that what you are doing is wrong. I can't tell him. But you tell him that this can't be done. They did nothing at all. They kept silent. And on the day when it was supposed to be delivered, he came to me and said, is the letterhead ready? So I told him, please talk to the manager. Okay. And he went to the manager, and the manager was not a very... His words used to all come out all garbled. He was not a very eloquent person, to say the least, okay? And he started, you know, our political party, you know, ashram, things like that, he started. And Udar understood. He got furious. And he started walking out in a rage. Udar used to get very angry, he used to get. So he started walking out. He walked out of the gate. And then he suddenly came back and he looked at me and he said, I asked you to do the work and you should have done it. And there was a big packet of ball bearings on the, about 2-3 kilos, and all solid metal. He took that and threw it into my face.
Whoa.
And it hit my spectacles and the spectacles flew off. And I went to get them. I didn't get injured. But this was it. And he came rushing towards me. Then, he was there. What's his name? The manager was there. And I said, well, what are you doing? No, this won't do and all that. And he stamped out. And he went and complained to Kunuma, who was the managing trustee at that time. Okay. So, then later on, the news spread that I had done nothing at all. I had only told him, think a little of what you have done. Is this the right action? Because violence in the ashram is not to be done. Then he met Robi. Because Robi was the manager's brother and he was coming in the... And he was very close to Robi. He says, hey, Robert, you know, I was asking... And Robi said, I don't even want to talk to you after what you have done. I am disgusted with you. I don't even want to talk to you. And he ticked him off. He said, you go. I am not going to talk to you also. Somehow this news spread like anything, and Dhuman Bhai one day walked all the way to the press. He came to me and told me, what you have done is very good. We are very, very happy that you didn't react. If you had reacted, maybe it would have been... Then he told me something which I totally disagree with. He said, if you had hit him back, it would have been a very serious matter. I said, what is this? If he hits me, it is not a serious matter. But if I hit him, it's a serious matter. I don't agree with this at all. So, anyway, so he said that, very good, we are very happy. And one day, Kunuma called me. Kunuma called me when the trustees were all having a meeting. And he said, there are three things that can destroy the ashram. Number one, financial mismanagement. Number two, scission. That means, scission means lack of unity. Okay. Third, violence. Then he said, financial mismanagement, we have not. We are all perfectly okay, there is no problem at all. Scission, well, Satprem has started the thing, but anyway, that problem also seems to be settled now. And violence, it's very good that you did not do any violence. Now I advise you never to do any work for Rudar again. You can take your revenge in this way. When he comes in, refuse to do his work. I said, of course not. Why should I refuse to do his work? It's not his work, it is mother's work. And if he comes from the department, then he'll certainly do the work. This was my starting relation with Rudar. And afterward, we had an extremely friendly relationship after this. He used to be so fond of me that he even sent Mona. Mona was the one looking after Golkon, and he sent Mona also to me one day for printing the most ordinary things, you know. Golkon pass, you know, at one time you needed a Golkon pass to go into Golkon. Nobody could go in, it was very strict. Mm-hmm. So she came with that and she said, I have come to you only because Laurie has asked me to come to you. He loves you and I want you to do this work for me because he has insisted. Otherwise, I wouldn't have come to you. I said, fine, no problem. So I'm mentioning this because I was very close to Udhar. So, I knew most of these people, not on intimate terms, but I even knew them.
Tell us some more about the press.
Well, the press was...
went through many changes.
Yes. Actually, before the press came into existence, mother used to get all the books done in Hyderabad. And there was a gentleman there, his name was Pillai. Many of those books are still, I have all many of those books, even those poems, and even Arjava. Arjava's poems also, I have the whole volume with me.
I have it too.
Yeah, but you don't have what I have. I have Sri Aurobindo's comments all noted down by Amal in his own handwriting in his book. You have that?
No.
So I have that too. I want to copy out all the comments that Sri Aurobindo had made about his poetry. Okay. So, yes, beautiful poems. Sri Aurobindo has given him high praise.
Very high.
Wonderful poetry.
He said he had a unique entry into an occult world.
Yes, that's right. Because he said, most probably in your past life, you were in Ireland. And Ireland is a very, very, psychologically, they are highly, very deep people. So, true. He was, you see, in English poetry, so many of them are Irish. Yeats was Irish.
A.E.
was Irish.
Shelley.
Then, the other one, the...
Shelley Black.
Huh?
Bernard Shaw.
Shelley was not Irish.
Blake.
No.
Blake was Irish. So there are so many of them were Irish. Even recently there was another one, I forget the name now, I can't remember the name. Modern poet.
O'Shaughnessy. I know who you're talking about. I can't get
I
the
can't
name
remember
name.
The name now. But
yeah.
Amal had a correspondence with him also regarding poetry and all. So anyway, so... what were they saying? I forgot.
The press. The change.
About the press, yes. Press. So those things used to be printed in. But mother wanted a press also. She was building up the whole ashram with all the departments and all that. She had already built up many departments and she said, we must have a press of our own. So she called Pillai, who was the manager in that place, and she said, I want you to organize and buy machinery for the press. So he did most of the work. He got second-hand machines, printing machines, folding machines, stitching machines and all that he got. Okay. So with those machines we continued for a fairly long time, but it was those days when you used to use metal types, you know.
Yeah,
for
you had to hand set everything.
Yes, you had to hand set everything. And then you had to correct them and then you had to proof them. It was a long process. Then in 1951 or 52, we got the Heidelberg automatic printing machine. Before that, it used to be all hand-fed machines. We used to feed by hand. So when the Heidelberg came, that was the first machine that came. That was in 1952. Then Jayantilal got involved, Udhar was involved, Roby got involved, and the modernization of the press started in about 1950 or so. I joined the press in 1960. After my schooling in this ashram school, I joined in 1960. I worked up to 2000. 40 years I was in the press. So, and then slowly the modernization started, one by one, one by one. Then in 1980, the computer technology had grown so fast and so much that photo composing came into the picture. And now everybody does their composing at home on a desktop. So that was the first time it came in. And when the New York Times changed over also to photo setting. Now if it is photo setting, you have to print by offset. So we had to buy offset machines. So in around 1970, we got our first offset machine. We went to Shivakashi and got an offset machine. At that time, Roby and Jayantilal were all there. We had gone together and we got that. Then, slowly, the letterpress, it used to be called the letterpress, when you print with metal letters, it was going defunct. And we had to sell off all the machines one by one. So I had to organize that to change over from entire letterpress to offset. So slowly we added offset machines, and it had to be done in such a way that the work is not disrupted. So the facilities in letterpress composing had to be there until we were quite capable of handling all the other works, and we had to add enough capacity here and then close down these machines. So it was quite a job, and that we had to do over 4 or 5 years, slowly change from letterpress to offset. So that mainly I had to do that work. And then when we did that, the whole huge one section of the press became redundant because all the photo composing and all that was there. So now what you see, those three-storied where residential quarters are there, that we rebuilt. So we went and made a basement below, and then we built 3 floors. And now there are 30 people who live in the press. At that time, only 3 people used to live in the press. Earlier, but mother said somebody must remain always in the press. 3 people. Now there are 30 people who live in the press. So the modernization of the press started, and it continued even after I gave up in 2000. I gave up. There are some disharmony was there, and they did not appreciate me, so I quit. And then I joined the archives. So in 2000 to 2006, I was working in the archives. And the modernization continued. They went into new machines, they went into 4-color machines. Now they are doing 4-color work, good work they are doing. And they have also now put solar panels on the press terrace. And now all the power is more main. Of course, they have an arrangement. You take from the power grid in Pondicherry, but you sell the power, that excess power you sell to the grid. And they reduce your bill amount. There is an arrangement like that. Yes. So now the ashram has got solar panels in the ashram press, in dining room, and in
school.
Somewhere else. In the school.
School.
It started with the school. Yeah. And there also they are now, they have excess power in school.
Oh. Mm.
So now they are thinking of library also they are thinking of. So this is a good trend, and the modernization is going on. It's good. New binding machines came into the picture. So all this work is going on. So the modernization has been there in all the departments, even in the laundry. Earlier we used to wash clothes with our hands. Now it is all machine washed, and even ironing is done by machines and all that. Hmm. So all the departments, there's been a modernization. We are keeping up with the latest technologies. Bread. Used to be also in the bakery, it used to be wood-fired ovens we used to have, okay? And now it is all diesel-fired and automatic, and there are machines which the bread is put in racks, and it goes round and round like that. It's all mechanized now. So Srivandi used to comment on him and says, this is from this plane of consciousness, that is from this plane of consciousness, this is psychic plane, that is the intuitive plane, this is from the touches of the overmind, he's gone. Giving him these things. So one day, Srivanda spoke about the overhead poetry, because the inspiration has to come from the higher mind. We said the ideal planes of consciousness, it has to come from there. And Srivanda could identify very clearly because of the quality of the vibration. You see that, and he says, this is coming from here, it's coming from there. So one day, Amal asked him, why don't you send me some samples of overhead poetry?
Yes.
So Srivanda said, okay. And he sent him a passage from Savitri, which was not published at all. It was absolutely secret. And he sent it to him. And Amal was highly excited about it. And he asked him, whose poetry is this? So Srivanda said, It is from my own writings of Savitri. Then he said, why don't you send me some more? This is how it started. And who was the messenger? It was Nalini. So Nalini, Sri Aurobindo used to put in and said, please don't speak about this to anybody. Maybe because he wanted to finish and he was going on upgrading his Savitri. So it used to be a sealed envelope and Nalini used to take it and give it to Amal. And this went on for a long time and then he used to take the thing back and Sri Aurobindo used to continue to send him bits and pieces of Savitri. One day, Nalini got quite curious. And he started asking him, but not in words. What is there in there? You are going on getting? Just by gestures he is asking about. So, Amal asked Sri Aurobindo that Nalini seems to be getting curious and he wants to know what is this thing. Can I tell him? The Sri Aurobindo says, you can tell only him. Okay. But keep this Savitri thing secret as yet. So, this was in the 30s. And when he started, he used to send him bits and pieces and so he used to type out. This is why we have all these so many letters which he has explored, every bit, and so has answered all those. But one thing is interesting, Amal had the gall to actually say, sir, is this line okay? Would this not be better? In fact, if you read the poetry, you will see often he is finding fault with some lines and saying, is this not better? And Sri Aurobindo invariably is saying, no, my version is better. So, it's quite a striking feature in his, if you see the questions, because most of the published things, Amal's answers, questions are not there. Sometimes they are there, but not always.
Yes.
But when the questions are there, you can see that it's pretty. Here is someone who is asking Sri Aurobindo whether this would not be better.
Sri Aurobindo made a slight change in now some. And then in some of them.
And he told mother, Sri Aurobindo said, only to satisfy them I am doing this. He told mother. Mother commented on this at one time. And that's why when she called Amal a imbecile, he is not there anymore, I can tell the story. She said he had the gall even to correct Sri Aurobindo's English. She mentioned that in one of our talks.
Yes.
Why it was a waste, you told. It was a waste, you said. Mother said it was a waste.
It was a
waste, you said, about Amal's.
She said that that so many letters Sri Aurobindo had to write on this. It was, I don't know if she used the word waste or anything, but she did say that it was, what Amal did was a little too much.
Yeah. I don't think she used the word waste.
No, I don't think so.
Because it's useful for the others, very useful indeed.
For me, it's been a godsend. I mean, I read the letters all the time. And the back, the last part is on the overhead gnosis. Incredible work. None of that would have happened without Amal.
He was an extraordinary person. In fact, if he were outside, he could have easily got the Nobel Prize for Literature. There's no doubt about it. He used to tell me, I have written 50 books.
Oh, yes.
Sri Aurobindo has written less, he has written only 40 books.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that story too, because he said, Sri Aurobindo is great because he wrote some 34 books, but I wrote 50.
We have a small trust, it's called the Clear Ray Trust.
Yes.
And we publish there books of Amal Kiran's. Fortunately, there is this house belongs to Rama. Opposite, there is this man, Hiralal. He is also from America and he also made his money in the motel business. So, and Hiralal Patel's friend, his name is Jayant, and he is in the US and he is an engineer. They funded all the books. They came to me one day in the press and said, we want you to print all of Amal's books and just send me the bill. There will be no problem at all. And then we made a trust. First, it was the Integral Life Foundation. Under that name. Then finally it was decided that there would be a trust here called the Clear Ray Trust. Clear Ray because Amal Kiran. So the trust was formed and then we started printing the books. We have printed almost all his books. Some of the books go out of print, then we keep reprinting those books. Otherwise, He has written any number of books on any number of subjects. Some of the books that he has written have even contributed to the Vedic theories, particularly about cotton. He has written one, Karpasa. He has written on how the reference to Karpasa is there, and that has changed even the Aryan invasion theory. Now it is largely debunked that it's not the right thing. But at one time it was very much current that this is what happened. So he also has contributed to that also. He has done a lot of research. He had a correspondence with an English person. He was a Christian, but he was attracted to the Vedanta philosophy. His name was B.D. Griffiths. B.D. Griffiths made an ashram in the south of India near Tanjavur somewhere. And he had a correspondence with him. So he was a mixture of Christian and Vedantic philosophy. He used to. And he did not believe that an avatar is possible, because that's a Christian tradition. They don't think that human beings can be divine. So he had a lot of correspondence with him. We have printed that book also. And this gentleman, so the book, the title of the book is
Disciple of Sri Aurobindo and a Follower of Christ.
That's right. That's right. A Disciple of Sri Aurobindo and a Follower of Christ. Under that, the whole correspondence with him is given. That's right.
He was a priest who was had a lot of correspondence with Aurobindo Basu. And I had to do some correspondence with him for Basu. So one day I invited him to the South Carolina Integral Yoga Retreat. And this was the most amazing thing. This man came to see Basu and stayed at Park Guest House. And he's sitting in his room and Sri Aurobindo materializes in front of him. And then he's at the airport in Chennai, Madras, and Sri Aurobindo again materializes in front of him. So he gave two talks. The first one was on Teilhard de Chardin and Sri Aurobindo. That went over most people's head. The second one he spoke about Sri Aurobindo, and he says, I am now an Aurobindonian Christian.
What was his name?
Name
is a problem.
I knew you were going to ask.
Yeah.
I have the same problem, but...
But he was a priest.
Yes. This was a wonderful evening, and we really appreciate the background on the press also.
Yeah.
A lot of people will... We'll enjoy that.
So we'll meet again after the 15th of August.
Yes.
When you come back, you will alert us and we will start our Life Divine again with the chapter on Maya.
Yes.
I remember the chapter.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Ranga. Namaste.
I should thank you.